Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Housing and Land Use Committee meeting for the City of Salinas. My sincere apologies for being late. I got my calendar mixed up and I didn't even have it on my radar for today. My sincere apologies. It won't happen again. Sorry to have taken up your time. We'll go ahead and call this meeting to order at 4:02 p.m. And Committee Member Osornio, can you please lead us in the pledge?
Yes. We all had to look for it. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We'll go ahead and call for roll call at this time.
Councilmember Osornio.
Here.
Chair Rocha.
Here. And it's my understanding Committee Member Sandoval is attending to a personal matter and won't be able to attend the meeting today. We'll go ahead and move on to public comment. Public comment is for items that are not on today's agenda, but within the subject matter jurisdiction of the committee. If you'd like to make a public comment, they are limited to 3 minutes per speaker. And we'll go ahead and open it up for public comment in the rotunda. Seeing none, we'll go out to Zoom.
No comments via Zoom.
No comments on Zoom. We'll move on to our consent agenda. We have one item on consent, and that's the minutes from the August 13th, 2024 Housing and Land Use Committee meeting.
Motion to approve.
I'll second that motion. We'll go ahead and do public comment on our consent agenda. Seeing none in the rotunda, we'll go out to Zoom.
No comments via Zoom.
No comments via Zoom. We'll bring it back to the committee and we'll call for a voice vote. And I'll second that motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, seeing none, the motion carries. We'll move on to our, there were several items. We'll move on to the, that's interesting. So I guess there were two more items of consent. That was a conditional commitment letter to the Housing Authority of the County of Monterey, as well as the 2024 Housing and Community Development Local Housing Trust Fund application. As I understand, those are also on consent, correct? All right, so then we already did our consent agenda, so we'll go on to our first item as an administrative report, and that's conditional commitment letter to the Housing Authority of County of Monterey for the development of Division Street properties.
Good afternoon, City Council members. My name is Luis Ochoa, and I will be presenting to you this item, the conditional commitment letter to the Housing Authority of the County of Monterey for the development of the Division Street.
Give me 1 minute. So what I'm going to do, because it's actually listed on the agenda as consent, I'm going to request a motion to pull both item ID 24 and 506 and ID 24 481 for separate action and discussion.
Second.
Okay, so I'll make that motion. It's been seconded by committee member Osornio. The first item has been approved. If members of the public would like to comment on these items, we're going to discuss them now. So we'll move on to ID 24506. Thank you.
So good afternoon. So I'll go to page 2 of this item. So just to give you some background on this project. So the intent of being able to put these conditional commitment letter is we have a new affordable housing project in the pipeline. And this project will be located at 7 small contiguous parcels that are currently owned by the City of Salinas. So the very first property is the one at the very corner, which is 921 East Market Street. And then the other 6 parcels are these that go from here all the way to the back. And that's the 115 and then the 151 Division Street. So there's 6 in total for a total of 2.5 acres. So this whole process has started really back in 2020. With the developer selection, as well as the announcement of the property within a surplus property. So back in October 2020, the city did two things simultaneously. So the city published a notice of finding availability of surplus property where these properties were included. And then the second one is the city released an RFP to identify and select a developer. When this RFP was released, there was only one proposal submitted to the city, and that was the Housing Development Corporation which is under the Housing Authority of the County of Monterey. And they were the selected developer to move forward with this project. With that in mind, the idea will be for the city to utilize the funds placed into the Salinas Local Housing Trust Fund in the amount of $3,080,000. And this total amount will be composed of the $1.3 million that you see there and change, which is the appraised value of the seven contiguous properties. And then the remainder of the funds will be kind of the cash funds in the Local Housing Trust Fund in the amount of $1.7 million. So that's the in total that how the $3,080,000 are composed that is intended to be allocated and committed towards this project. Where are the funds gonna be used? So these funds will be used, of course, the land donation, pre-development of the project, and then the construction. Should there be enough funds left for the construction piece, the intent is that those funds get rolled over for when the project is under construction. How big is the project gonna be? We're talking about currently, as of this date, a 48 unit project that is gonna hit the below three income categories. Low, very low, extremely low, farm worker families. What is this conditional commitment letter include? So it does have some terms, being that the funds that we're talking about are the funds that are under the Salinas Local Housing Trust Fund. We're talking about that this is intended to be for pre-development, kind of pre-construction, gap financing funds. It will have a simple interest loan in the form of a 3%. It is gonna be a 55-year loan term that the Housing Authority will have to repay the loan, and as well as a accompanying 55-year affordability period for the project. All of these are regulations of the local housing trust funds that we receive from the state and from the already established Salinas Local Housing Trust Fund. So with that said, the recommended motion is that the Housing and Land Use Committee supports the approval of the City Council resolution authorizing the approval of a conditional commitment letter to the Housing Authority of the County of Monterey for pre-development and construction costs in the amount of $3,080,000 from the Salinas Local Housing Trust Fund for a proposed 100% affordable multifamily rental housing project at the Division Street properties, which include 921 East Market and 115 through 151 Division Street. With that, I conclude my presentation and I will open it to questions and comments.
Thank you, and I believe this is actually in your district, Councilmember Sornio, so I'll open it up for questions and we'll go to you.
Thank you. Can you go back to the slide of the parcels or they're split up? And okay, thank you. And I just have just a couple, just real, in my opinion, I think they might even be yeses and nos. But so the parcel, it looks like it's 151. So all of those parcels will make up 48 units?
Yes, so the intent is that these seven contiguous parcels will become one, and that's where the 2.5 acre really area is. And within this 2.5 acre, that is intent that is gonna become a 48, currently, a 48-unit proposed,
great,
100% affordable housing project.
Will this be? Will it be like a mixed use at all? Will it have any type of kind of like anything on the bottom, or will it be single story?
Good afternoon, Councilmember Sonia, Lisa Brinton, Community Development Director. So the proposal that we received was on what we're calling phase one of the Division Street properties. We do continue to coordinate with the county that owns property to the north, as well as the adjacent property owners to, I guess that's east-west directionally on the right of the screen, the Teamsters, as well as there are Clinica de Salud has expressed interest in their needs to expand. The original project was mixed use in the context as they were looking for amenities. We need to keep in mind that this is adjacent to a riparian corridor, and the Alisal Vibrancy Plan identified a priority of creating open space as well as connectivity mm-hmm. to the Cesar Chavez Park. So there are going to be setbacks and there are going to be open space amenities that would be included, as well as community spaces for the residents. So it's not just strictly residential units. It has been the goal all along to look at this area in a more comprehensive way for phased development. And so there have been conversations with adjacent property owners that have more of a retail commercial use, but we did not. We want to move forward with this aspect of the project while bringing them along with us to see how we can all work together to really make an impact in this area.
Great. Okay. That's good to know. Thank you. So that was going to be one of my questions, obviously, with creating the units is good, but having some of those amenities is going to make it really really tie it together. The other question that I had was, if I understand this correctly, the city owns these parcels. So we would be maybe sometime down the line giving these to the Monterey County or the Housing Authority of the Monterey County. Is that correct?
Actually, within the commitment letter, those properties, the valuation of those properties will be included in the commitment. So that's how we reach
the $3,080,000. Okay.
Because at the same, and there will be more steps ahead. So this is just to do a conditional commitment letter, but there will be more steps to actually then give the property, donate the property to the Housing Authority.
Okay. And then, so, I mean, this would be a loan at a 3% rate then, right? So that's pretty good, right?
According to today's terms,
we're not coming out of pocket for anything, and we're getting 48 units. It's going to be in an area where there's a really big community park, and there's other things that are walkable distance. Okay, no further questions. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. And Councilmember Osornio asked most of the questions that I had, but just to clarify, did you say it's going to be a $30 million project altogether? Or how much is the project going to cost altogether?
As of right now, we have actually asked the Housing Authority for a preliminary pro forma. And if I remember correctly, it was in the $24 million that this project will cost. We'll know more refined numbers actually as the project gets developed. Mm-hmm. There's construction drawings. Then the Housing Authority will then pursue the other funds, and then by then we will actually know the more accurate number as to how much the project is going to cost. But as of right now, the preliminary pro forma is showing $24 million.
And is there a developer that's already been identified for this project?
Sorry, can you repeat that question again?
Has there been a developer identified for the project?
That will be the Housing Authority of the County of Monterey.
Got it. Because now they joined, because there's two separate entities before, so...
Before they were kind of two, but now they're really becoming under the same house. Right. And, these funds will be going towards the Housing Authority of the County of Monterey, and they will be ultimately the agency that will be developing the property.
Got it. And I asked a question about the budget because there's been some situations in the past to where we were having discussions about granting money and it didn't seem like all the funding sources were fully identified, and then it ended up being a situation to where we ended up not moving forward with that project. So do you anticipate that the vast majority of the funding sources have been identified for the construction of this project, or where are we at on that?
So this project is kind of really at the very early stages of development. So we're really in the pre-development phase. And the Housing Authority really needs these funds to really kickstart all of that pre-development phase that could take anywhere between 1 to 2 years so that they can then get their entitlement documents. And then they'll start working in, crafting and building their building permit sets and everything else to package the project and then have a better number as to how much the project is going to cost so that they can then pursue tax credits, which is... as you guys are aware, at least for the state of California, that's the biggest funding source to any affordable housing project, especially when you're talking about a project that is going to be 20-plus units. It is going to need to tap into tax credits to make it happen.
Absolutely. That was my only question. We'll go out for public comment on this item, and we'll start the public comment in the rotunda. Seeing none, we'll go out to Zoom.
No public comment via Zoom.
No comments on Zoom. We'll bring it back to the committee, and I'll open it up for motion at this time.
Yeah, Chair, if I may, can I just give some comments real quick? Something.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
So my only comment would be, as always, just the engagement of the folks that are in that area. I know that Clinica and the Teamsters have obviously been around and they know about this. I remember even having a meeting when I first got on council as well there. But I would just say maybe the apartment complex that is literally right to the side of it, and maybe even kind of like maybe a small radius. I understand that this is the beginning stages of it, but maybe even conversations about like, you know, as it goes, you guys identifying a good place to kind of just bring up that conversation. Because in my opinion, the breakdown of how this will be, the money will be basically the way I look at it is a loan to the housing, to the housing authority. I mean, it makes really good sense. We're finding an infill project. There's a loan, we're getting back a percentage. So I see that good. 55 years of affordability. It would just be unfortunate that as we're going, there may be some rumbling that comes up. But I think just educating the public and the neighbors, I think that we'll put something really good together. Where even bringing this to, I know that we had a county supervisors. We were on, I think, like a ad hoc committee with county supervisors where we talk about those things. Really having buy-in from Supervisor Luis Alejo is going to be important because he does represent this area as well. And also there's been some conversation that's been had about doing a feasibility study with the youth center that's up there on the other side as well. So just as we move this forward, I know that you guys will find the perfect place to kind of bring those two together. So just wanted to say that publicly. Thank you. No further questions or comments.
I echo the sentiments of my colleague. I think that making sure we engage the community around this project can be critical to have that neighborhood support and make sure that it's something that is just has its praises being sung throughout the entire process, right? Which is what we really want with critical projects such as these. But thank you for your leadership on this. I think this is a great initiative for us to take. Happy to partner with the Housing Authority and happy to make a dent on meeting our community's needs, especially as it relates to affordable housing for those particular income categories. I think it'll be fantastic for our community. So at this point in time, I'd accept a motion on the item.
Motion to approve.
And I will second that motion. We'll go ahead and call for a voice vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, seeing none, the motion carries. We'll move on to the other item on consent, and that is the 2024 California Department of Housing and Community Development and Local Housing Trust Fund application.
Good afternoon, council members. My name is Monica Flores. I am a community development analyst with the Community Development Department. I'm here to present to you all the 2024 Local Housing Trust Fund application. A little background on this. This is with the California Department of Housing and Community Development. The Local Housing Trust Fund put out a notice of funding availability for approximately $53 million statewide. The application requirements are anywhere from $500,000 to $5 million. This is specific to new and existing local housing trust fund, as well as local and regional local housing trust fund. We are local and are existing as we applied last year. The application requires a dollar-for-dollar match, which would include non-state dollars as well as property assets. It could be either or a combination of both. And as existing local housing trust fund, it does require a 3 years of ongoing revenue for existing local housing trust fund, averaging $100,000 per year. Moving forward with our discussion, the Salinas Local Housing Trust Fund intent is to fund and finance the planning and construction of affordable housing. This is a citywide approach, and it would focus on the included match properties if any were identified. This year, we have not identified any match properties to include in the application. It will all be in cash. Our city council serves as the board of directors, and they are responsible for the general oversight and consideration of emerging projects and developments. And the required application threshold is to follow all of the Salinas Local Housing Trust Fund guidelines and standards. Moving forward to the requirements of the 2024 application, The first requirement is, as an existing local housing trust fund, we must meet a $1 million request with the match amount in the same amount. We are currently working with our finance department to research potential funding sources, and these may include our previous allocation of local housing trust fund that was not awarded, as well as general funds, any ARPA, as well as any PLHA fundings. The second requirement is to commit 40% of our previous award, and this is to the presentation that my supervisor, Luis Ochoa, previously provided to you all, and this would be satisfied with the conditional commitment letter to the Housing Authority of Monterey County and the amount of $3,080,000. The third requirement is to have the ongoing revenue averaging $100,000 per year for 3 years, and we're looking into using the PLHA and PEEP funding. And the last requirement is that our application deadline is September 17th, 2024, and today we are here to present to you all, and next week we will be coming as well for consent with our City Council. A little bit in regards to our timeline, the California Department of Housing and Community Development released the notice of funding availability on July 9th, 2024. August 20th, 2024, they opened their application portal. Again, we are here today for your housing and land use consideration. Next week, we will be going to City Council for their consent as well. And our application deadline is September 17th, 2024. We expect to receive the award notifications December of 2024. With that, I conclude my presentation and recommended motion is recommended that the Housing and Land Use Committee supports the approval of a City Council resolution authorizing the submittal of the 2024 Local Housing Trust Fund application to the California Department of Housing and Community Development on or before our deadline of September 17, 2024. With that, I conclude my presentation and I open it to any questions or comments.
Thank you. We'll go ahead and open it up for questions, and we'll start with Committee Member Osornio.
I know that for us, it's obviously very important to have our reserves in case, you know, anything ever happens, we ever go through another, you know, God forbid, a pandemic or a recession and things like that. But as you guys are looking for funding for the match, are we looking at all different, are we looking into even like our reserves as being able to use some of that money? I know that obviously it's very important to have that in case something really bad happens, right? We could continue city services, but at the same time, just thinking about how much of a need housing is right now, and can you just speak to that really quickly?
Sure, of course. And we are wanting to, I first want to say that we are wanting to maximize our contribution because we've been notified that this is the last round of local housing trust fund monies. So this is the last opportunity for us to leverage one-to-one dollars for projects that we do have coming through the pipeline and anticipate coming through the pipeline. We have been working with our finance department to identify appropriate funding sources and approach. So, yes, we haven't specifically talked reserves, but that is definitely something that we can research. And when we come to City Council, we will have a recommendation as to the appropriate match amount and funding source.
And then my final question, just that you're there now, Lisa, thinking about the fact that I can't remember if it was 12 million or 14 million of ARPA funds that are still, we just had a presentation, I think, that needed to come to council. Is that something also that may be used in some way?
So we do have to keep in mind the ARPA requirements that funds have to be encumbered by the end of this year, 2024. So we're looking at having things encumbered, locked in by November and funds spent by 2026. With the Local Housing Trust Fund, we do have a 5-year window from the date of the award to commit the funds to a specific project. That's not even the funds spent. So ARPA works on a little bit of a different timeline, so we are trying to just look holistically what are the projects we need to fund and matching them with the right funding source at this point.
Okay, and thank you for that. Chair, would you like for me to do comments now, or would you like that afterwards? Thank you. Okay, so no further questions. Thank you.
My only question would be to, and obviously you're already going to do your due diligence, but just want to say from the committee standpoint to double check with legal and whether or not we could use unspent funds from this housing trust fund application for funding for future ones. I'll never forget the, and I wasn't on the council at the time, but the green car situation that happened. And so ever since then, I'm like, let's be careful with how we appropriate certain funding sources. So, but other than that, I have no further questions. But thank you for your hard work on this, and thank you for your initiative. It really is important. We'll go out for public comment on this item. Seeing none, we'll go out to Zoom.
No comment via Zoom.
All right, we'll bring it back to the committee for final comments and direction. We'll go to committee member Osornio.
Yeah, I just remember the first time that we applied for this, the local housing trust fund. I also remember when one of my colleagues made a motion to allocate millions of dollars to affordable housing, and we were told we were never going to spend it. And I think we did a pretty good job of getting it out the door. I would just say that if this is the last round, I would just say my position as a member of this committee and also as a council member, I would be very supportive of the work that you guys are able to do to really look into seeing how we can maximize this final opportunity to find funding. It's very, very evident that we get people in here all the time that are talking about their housing situations. I mean, it's whether you're a renter, whether you're trying to buy your home for the first time. Housing is a really big issue here in Salinas. And if we are really trying to find a solution, then we really have to have the political will to really put our monies where our mouth is. And I think that this council, just in the proof of the last couple of years, we've been willing to take the recommendations from the Housing and Land Use Committees and Community Development and really be intentional with finding that funding and having the political will when you guys come forward. I would just say that if there's anything, I'm very supportive of you guys continuing that work. Thank you.
Thank you.
I also just want to thank you all for the work that you're doing. I mean, the work that you do is second to none in the region on the issues of housing, and so it takes great leadership and work on your behalf. And please know, you know, I fully support you and the work that you do, and I also support whatever we can do to maximize this opportunity and really secure as much funding as we can, especially considering this is the last time that this funding opportunity will be available for local jurisdictions. As we're seeing, not only is there a great housing need in our community, but the work that we're doing is having real life impacts on the constituents that we serve. And so anything we could do to continue the great work that you do and meet our housing needs and serve our community, I'm fully in support of. So thank you. I'll entertain a motion at this time.
Motion to approve.
I'll second that motion. We'll call for a voice vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Seeing none, the motion passes. We'll move on to the United States Department of Housing and Urban Development Consolidated Annual Performance and Evaluation Report for fiscal year 2023-2024.
So, good afternoon, committee members. My name is Christina Gonzalez. I will be presenting an overview of the fiscal year 2023-24 Consolidated Annual Performance and Evaluation Report, also known as the CAPER, that will be submitted to the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. About the CAPER, so the city is in an entitlement jurisdiction, and in order for us to maintain that status and keep our federal funds, we are required to report annually on our accomplishments and our expenditures. So it would be for fiscal year 2023-24, based on the annual action plan that was approved, and then which also ties into our consolidated plan for fiscal year 2020-24. The CAPER is due to HUD 90 days after the end of the fiscal year. For us, that would be September 27, 2024. So a little bit of background. We are required to do a 15-day public comment. We did publish on the Herald in English and Spanish on August 23, 2024, which would provide our public hearing to be September 10, 2024. We did make the CAPER available online on our city webpage, in person or by appointment at our community development office, as well as the city hall, and then also at our three public libraries. And the public is also able to request that via email. So a little bit about our HUD funding and expenditures. So as you can see, we have our federal programs, which is CDBG, Community Development Block Grant. We also have CDBG COVID that we had some funding remaining and then we're trying to spend down. The Home Partnership Investment Program, HOME, the Home American Rescue Plan, also known as HOME ARP, which is a one-time allocation. Also the Emergency Solution Grant, and then we also have that one-time allocation of ESG COVID, which we actually had remaining from 2020 allocation, and we finally spent down. So in total, we had a little bit over $15 million in available funding. For our fiscal year, we did spend a little bit over $4 million in housing, capital improvement projects, and just homelessness. So for our CDBG accomplishments, I do want to highlight that we did have housing production, housing units that were created. So we did have Parkside, which provided, That would be Sun Rose Apartments that actually received CDBG funding, a total of $1 million. And then for last fiscal year, we actually spent $459,000 in order to close out that project. The city did allocate funding to subrecipients for the First United Methodist Church for the rehabilitation of the kitchen to provide meals for the homeless, and then also provided funding for the LaSalle Union School District for the Buckhorn Project, Early Childhood Development Project. So that project plus the Methodist Church spent over $2 million. And that's gonna help provide a public facility for the public and its residents. And then we also see that we did allocate funding for our public services, which went out to our SORT team and ECHO Housing in total for $275,000. They did spend $83,000 last fiscal year, which they were able to service 393 households. And then we did spend some of our remaining CDBG COVID funds. $59,000 was spent on admin staff. $352,000 was spent on Downtown Streets and ECHO, and they actually served 57 households. So for fiscal year 23-24, our ESG program, we did allocate $218,000 to our SORT and community homeless solutions. They were able to spend only $12,000 of that funds. However, they were able to assist 55 households. So big accomplishment that with so little funds, we were able to service that many individuals. And then our ESG COVID, we did have $105,000 of funding available from the allocation, and we actually were able to spend down all those funds. So that has been, that granting source has been closed already. And then for our home, unfortunately, we have not been able to commit our remaining funds of 2.5. However, we are working closely with some of the for-profit and nonprofit developers to get that funding allocated within this fiscal year. However, we were able to spend down funding that had been previously allocated to Parkside, which created 80 housing units that were all 100% affordable, and 6 of those units were restricted to home funding. And so for our home ARP, we have not spent any funds for that. We are still looking at what projects or what resources we can use to get that money spent down and help our residents here. So with that, that concludes our annual spending, our accomplishments for federal funding. So it is recommended that the Housing and Land Use Committee support the approval of a City Council resolution to submit the fiscal year 23-24 Consolidated Annual Performance and Evaluation Report to HUD. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll open it up to questions from the committee. Committee Member Osornio.
Yeah, one of the questions I had, I think that I always ask it on this report, but Sherwood, the rec center that's out there, I mean, where are we at with that project? I think we've been working on that one. I know that when the remodeling of the roof and things were kind of ticking out of City Hall, and I think they might even be there, but can you talk about kind of like where that's at?
Yes, so the city did get into contract with a professional service agreement with CSG for them to help us with project management. So right now we are currently working on the RFP. We just released the FONSI, which is,
So we just recently released, so basically what Christine is saying, we finished the NEPA environmental review for the project, and once that is completed, we have to release what is called a FONSI RROF, which is a public notice that is required for HUD in relation to environmental reviews. So for that, we are under an 18-day public comment period, so that is coming up pretty soon. Once that happens, we are going to then send a different form, which is called the RROF and certification to HUD, and they're going to have another 15-day comment. And after that 15-day comment, we're going to get what is called the AUGF, the Authority to Use Grant Funds. Once we have that on hand, we will be able to release the project's RFP out to publication. So simultaneously, in addition to having the NEPA going underway and completing that, the project has been 100% designed. It's currently under building permit review, and so we're contemplating within the next month to anywhere between 1 to 3 months, we will be completely approved with a set of building permits that we can then, we will be able to take it out for an RFP. So that's where that project is at. So it is getting very close to being released for the RFP, so that we can then hopefully get proposals and select a general contractor and then move forward with the actual construction and upgrades to the exterior mostly, which is what is gonna be the focus of phase 4 of Sherwood.
Good, thank you. Thank you for that explanation. It makes it very clear. Yeah, these things, it's just, I mean, it's the process, you know? We have to do this process. So. Good to know that it is on its way. The other question I was going to have is there was some funding here. I forgot exactly in what slide it said, but it was that there's some funds that may be able to be used for nonprofit or for-profit developments. I forget what, maybe that was in, can you go back? Home. So for the home funds, let's see. I think if you could go out to that slide really quickly. Let's see, here it is, here. So $2,542,134. Has there been any potential of folks that are, that maybe, that the community development might be looking at as far as, because I know that there's a project that's, I think it's called like the East Market Project or something. I don't know if that's for profit, nonprofit, but I know that that's a project that's been kind of underway for some time. Has that, are they maybe in the, are they a potential person that can be awarded that money?
So the only thing with home funds is once you commit, you do have a limited time to expense those funds.
Okay.
So we're only looking at projects that are more shovel ready.
Okay.
So one would be the St. George, which is at 55 Kip Drive. That is getting a little bit more closer. So we are in discussion as far as what we're able to provide as far as funding.
Good, okay. Okay, no further questions. Thank you, Chair.
My question is actually also on the home funds. I was wondering if by any chance, like if we're unable to spend the funds, three options is number one, if we could use those funds for the local housing trust fund application, or I remember we got like the state family homeless challenge grant that I believe we used to purchase single family homes to then turn into multifamily housing. I wonder if this would be an opportunity to use these funds for a similar kind of a project.
So we are looking at what the eligible activities. So we are reviewing that because we do understand that there is a time frame for us to commit the funds. And I believe we were looking at some tenant-based assistance, maybe shifting that to help residents. However, that we're still in conversation. And hopefully, once we have a concrete plan, we'll go ahead and present that to council.
Do you know if it's limited to housing production costs or housing work in general?
So specifically, home is really targeted to the production of new housing units. It's allowed to more than just housing, but you know those activities are typically the home funds can be used for acquisition. And then the development of new housing, then you have the TBRA, the Tenant-Based Rental Assistance Program, that could be developed. It could be used to help city residents with purchasing of single family homes. But within that, it's rather complicated in our community because of the housing market and the cost of these units. It makes it very, very hard for us as a city to be able to provide assistance because there are some special regulations around the home program. And that I think homes will have to be within the 95 percentile of the market price. And it will be very hard for our residents that are low income to be able to find those homes. There's very few. And so, I mean, there's a couple of options, but definitely right now as a division, we're currently exploring all the potential options that we have to be able to encumber these funds into a program that will work and that will benefit the entire community.
Understood. That was my only question. We'll go out for public comment on this item. Seeing none in the rotunda, we'll go out to Zoom. None on Zoom, we'll bring it back to the committee for final comments and direction. We'll start with Committee Member Osornio.
Yeah, thank you. I think as we start, and maybe this is a conversation for like maybe way in the future, but I think just the creativity of being able to purchase, you know, I think about some. I think about that new project that's on Abbott. There's like apartments that are out there, and I'm wondering if there's even such thing of like purchasing like five apartments, right? Like, I don't know. I don't know where that is at if apartment developers or property owners are thinking about doing things like that. But I find it that if there's things that we can purchase that are like, that we would be able to have to make affordable, I think it would be, it'd be a good thing to look into to see if maybe we can partner up with some of these apartment complexes or property owners and stuff, and maybe it would be used as like subsidizing the rent or something. I don't know. Just I guess maybe I'm just brainstorming out loud, but I know that you guys are always looking for different ways to be able to spend some of these funds. So I just look forward to the next report that you guys have, but. Definitely in support of this one. So I'd like to make a motion to approve, Chair.
Right, I'll second your motion. Along those lines, as we are going to be building out the future growth area there, especially in the central area specific plan, they have in their affordable housing plan categories for very low-income, low-income workforce and moderate housing. And so perhaps we could use some of these unspent home funds for loans to help people with that down payment for the homes that will be affordable and for sale within the future growth area in those categories of workforce and low income and moderate around there and very low income. That way we can help people to be able to get into the housing market because although they are going to be set aside for people who fall within those income categories, you still have to qualify for the loans. You still have to go through the process of qualifying to be able to go through the process of purchasing a home. So there's still certain obstacles in place. And so perhaps this can be a vehicle to address some of those issues. But other than that, I'm in support of this and we'll go ahead and call for a voice vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, seeing none, the motion carries. We'll go ahead and move on to administrative reports. Seeing none, we'll go on to future agenda items. I have none, I don't know about you. Seeing none, we'll go on to adjournment at 4:48 p.m.